Our study of the book of 1 Corinthians takes us now to the 12th chapter of the book, as well as the 12th problem that Paul deals with in this letter, the 12th problem concerning the church, which is the problem concerning spiritual gifts. And it is the first of three chapters that in one way or another deals with this topic. He deals with it in this chapter, chapter 12, in a more general way, dealing with its ramifications of their inappropriate handling of those gifts, the fact that they are now a divided people within that congregation, and they are not as united as they should be, which those gifts were supposed to do to bring about unity. Instead, they were being divided amongst themselves. In chapter 13, which we'll get to next week, the writer takes it from the standpoint of a discussion of love, but connects that with the overall topic of this section of the letter, of miraculous gifts and how they should be desiring love and not the specific gifts that they have and that they're fighting over. And then in chapter 14, the last of these three chapters, he deals with specifically the gift of tongue speaking and addresses the overall problem they're having concerning that gift, which is those who have it are bragging about it, those who do not have it are envious of those that do, and that's causing all sorts of problems. But it begins here in chapter 12 with a more general topical discussion of these miraculous gifts, as well as a discussion of the kind of gifts that were being given, and so on and so forth, as well as, later in this chapter, a discussion of division in general. But you can easily see how it applies to the miraculous gifts. Let's begin in chapter 12 and notice how it starts in verse 1. "Now concerning spiritual brethren, I would not have you ignorant." The King James Version has the word gifts there in italics, but it's only in italics because it wasn't in the original. If you did not have it, as it is to be read in the Greek, he's simply saying now concerning spiritual or concerning handouts of grace. In other words, we're talking about these miraculous gifts that were distributed by the hands of the apostles. And the Bible speaks of this practice being done throughout the first century. Probably the most clearly stated example comes in Acts chapter 8, when Philip the evangelist, not an apostle, went down to the city of Samaria and preached Christ and converted many of that region. And then later, after those Christians at Samaria had been established, they called for Peter and John, who came down, Peter and John, who are apostles, and then laid hands on the people of Samaria that they might receive the gift of the Holy Spirit, being miraculous gifts, the ability to do miracles, of which we'll read about in 1 Corinthians 12. You can also read in Acts chapter 19, Paul coming across certain disciples of Apollos in Corinth, in that region, who, after discussing with them and after talking with them, realized that they were not, in fact, Christians yet. They had been baptized under John's baptism, but after the fact, after John's baptism had already become null and void. And so he taught them the truth, baptized them into Christ, and then laid hands on them that they might receive the gift of the Holy Spirit, being miraculous ability. As it says at the end of that text, at the beginning of Acts 19, after he laid hands on them, they received the Holy Spirit and then began to speak in other tongues. They began to do miracles. And so as you come in 1 Corinthians 12, the practice of miraculous gifts being distributed among Christians in the first century congregations is already established. It is commonplace. What you have in Corinth is a congregation that is already divided. It is already divisively minded. And this only exacerbates the problem, these miraculous gifts that they have. And so he says, now concerning these gifts, now concerning these handouts of grace, this spiritual things, brethren, I would not have you unlearned. You know that you were Gentiles, verse 2, carried away unto these dumb idols, even as you were led. You remember how you were once pagans who followed after false gods, but now you are Christians following after the one true God. Wherefore I give you to understand that no man speaks things by the Spirit of God, or no man that speaks things by the Spirit of God, calls Jesus accursed. And no man can say that Jesus is Lord, but by the Holy Spirit. Put this in the context of these Christians who have these miraculous gifts. He is telling them the purpose and the importance of these gifts in the first century. Now, these gifts, as we'll study them, are not available to us Christians in the 21st century. Nor do we need them, nor should we want them. The purpose for those gifts was as a stopgap to help the Christians until the Word of God was completed. Its written form had been completed. And once that Bible, as we have it now, bound in leather, was fully written, with the last letter being Revelation, at the close of the first century. Once those letters were distributed and in the hands of Christians, they could then turn, as we do, to the Word of God, pore over its Word and its content, and understand the divine will of Christ. And they could use that to ascertain whether a person was telling the truth or a false teacher. Whether a person was speaking damnable heresies, for example, saying that Jesus Christ is not come in the flesh, as John will talk about. Or as he words it here, no man that speaks by the Spirit of God calls Jesus accursed. Well, that's specific, but just generalize it. What is that but false doctrine? And no one can say that Jesus is the Lord but by the Holy Spirit, but by the miracles that that person can do to confirm his message. No one can preach a confirmed by the apostles, a confirmed by God message in the first century unless they can show you that they're a true teacher, which means they can do a miracle to prove it. We don't need that in the 21st century because if I go to preach somewhere and I preach a sermon, the brethren can open up their Bibles, completed revelation, and compare my words to the Word of God. And if my word doesn't match up with the Word of God, they know that the Word is truth and my words are error. But they didn't have the Word of God in written form as we have it today. It was still being written and delivered to them, case in point, this letter that is being penned as we study it. And so if a Christian in Corinth is going to hear a teacher or a preacher preach, they're going to need to know that the message coming out of the mouth of that teacher is truth or error, so that they can know to either accept it or reject it. How would they know that? Unless that person has the ability to do a miracle, that is, these gifts given by the Holy Spirit. Verse 4, now there are diversities of gifts, but the same Spirit. Over and over through this text, there is either by implication or just by just directly stated phrase, references to unity, references to not being divided, but to being one. And the way he words it here is a good example of that in verse 4. There is a diversity of gifts, as we'll see in the next few verses. These are very different kinds of gifts that serve very different purposes and are used at very different times. But they are all given by the one Spirit of God. The one aspect of that triune being, the Holy Spirit of God, gives these gifts. Verse 5. And there are differences of administrations. There are different offices that Christians hold within the church. Some might be preachers or teachers. Some might be deacons or elders. Different offices, but the same Lord who is over all. You see, differences but unity. Division yet united. Not division in a negative sense, but just simply division of you have an office and I hold a different position, yet we're united. Verse 6. And there are diversities of operations, different functions, different people doing different things, but the same God which works all in all. You're doing something different from what I'm doing, but we're not antagonistic toward each other because you're doing something different from me, but we're both doing the same thing for God, you see. Verse 7. But the manifestation of the Spirit is given to every man to profit with all. In other words, to profit the majority. These gifts given by the Holy Spirit were uniquely given, individually given to individual Christians. And one was given one gift and another was given a different gift. Not one Christian other than the apostles who distributed these gifts, not one Christian was given all of the gifts. In other words, in order for the entire scheme to work, every single Christian having their own individual gift would have to work together. And if they don't work together, the whole system falls apart. And he tells you the reason why. He does that in verse 7. The manifestation of the Spirit, the gifts given by the Spirit, is given to every man individually to profit everybody collectively. In order for us to work together, we have to work together. In order for us to be together, we have to work together. So the Spirit was very wise, being God, that makes sense, to distribute these gifts individually, but making it so only you have one piece of the puzzle and you have to fit your piece with theirs to see the whole picture. Verse 8. For to one is given the Spirit, and now he begins the listing from verse 8 and 9 and 10 of these miracles. One is given by the Spirit the word of wisdom, to another the word of knowledge by the same Spirit, to another faith by the same Spirit, to another gifts of healing by the same Spirit, to another the working of miracles, to another prophecy, to another discerning of spirits, to another diverse kinds of tongues, to another the interpretation of tongues. And so there are, if my count is correct, 9 individual gifts described here. Each one has a different function. Some are similar. You can certainly group some together, but they are individual in their functions, and they're individual in who in the congregation can perform these functions. Let's notice them now. Look at verse 8. For to one is given by the Spirit the word of wisdom. Wisdom being the ability to apply what? To another, knowledge, the word of knowledge. Knowledge, which is general information. And so one expounds the Scripture, the other one explains the Scripture. By the same Spirit, however, the one Spirit is giving these gifts. Therefore, if they're used correctly, we should all be united to that one who's given the gifts. Verse 9, to another, faith. Now let's take these next three here found in verse 9 and group them together. Faith, gifts of healing, and in verse 10, the working of miracles. Each one is similar in execution, but is used for a different purpose. You have faith. Jesus on one occasion mildly rebuked his disciples when they came to him and said, Master, why could we not cast out the devil that was the demon that was in this person? And Jesus says, because you didn't have enough faith. If you had enough faith, you could not just say to a demon, get out. With enough faith, you could say to a mountain, move over there. You could have enough faith, just if you had enough as of the size of a mustard seed, you could move mountains. Well, that's this kind of faith, the kind of faith that does something, that demonstrates power to show the hearer or the seer that the person doing that power is a person of God. Faith. The other, though, the gifts of healing. Now, again, the gift of healing is a working of faith. It is also a miraculous ability, which he says in verse 10, all of these are miracles, but it's a specific kind of working of faith. This one is specifically to the helping of someone who is impaired in some way, blind or unable to walk or deaf, always on the helping side. The kind that strikes someone blind, the kind that strikes someone lame, the kind that strikes someone dead, in fact, is the next word, the working of miracles. All of these are miracles, but this means the exercising of power, miracles. Well, that I always took to be like Paul when he struck Elymas blind. A miracle where someone who was speaking against the word of God, you might strike them mute so that they couldn't speak. Or someone you could be striking them dead with the miraculous power. For example, Ananias and Sapphira in Acts chapter 5. So you have three different categories of basically the same function. You're working some miraculous power on someone or on something for all the same purpose, though, to confirm in that seer or hearer that the person working the miracle is of God. If I can't do the miracle, you have no reason to trust me in the first century. Just like in the 21st century, if I'm not following the miraculously inspired book, you have no reason to listen to me. And so these three, they serve different functions. Faith, a demonstration of power, just in general. You have gifts of healing, a demonstration of power to help someone, to confirm the message. And then the working of miracles, a demonstration of power against someone, to still confirm the message. For example, when Ananias and Sapphira were struck dead in Acts 5, immediately after that, the whole congregation feared, had reverence for the apostles, which served the purpose of that miracle. So the people would learn to listen and trust and obey the apostles of Jesus Christ. So faith, healing, working of miracles. And then he says to another, prophecy. Prophecy being foretelling or forthtelling, which is, even though, as we'll see in chapter 14, tongue speaking, the one coming up, is the most coveted after gift at Corinth, it is the most unnecessary gift. If there's one gift that you absolutely should want, they're all necessary, but that one is on the bottom of the ladder. The one that's on the top of the ladder is prophecy. That's the gift that you need when you don't have inspired writing. You need to be able to foretell and to forthtell the word of God. To another, the discerning of spirits, to know whether someone is telling truth or lie. How important is that when someone comes in to teach? You see how necessary these gifts were in the first century. And to another, kinds of tongues, diverse different kinds of tongues, and the interpretation of tongues. Those are two separate gifts. One would speak in a language that he never studied. One would interpret the language that he never studied. One person didn't have speaking and interpreting. One had to speak, the other had to interpret. If you want to get anything out of the message, they both have to work together. So those are the nine miracles, as Paul lists them. But all these, verse 11, works that one and selfsame Spirit, the one Spirit, divides to every man severally. He separates the gifts up as he, the Spirit, wills. The Holy Spirit is a he. The Holy Spirit is a person as much as, not a person like a human being person, Jesus was a human being, but the Father is not. He is a person, though. He is a living, thinking entity, same as the Holy Spirit. He is God. He is just as much a He as Christ is a He, and the Father is a He, not an it. The Holy Spirit is not an it. We should be careful not to call the Holy Spirit an it. I would be offended if someone called me an it. He divides up the gifts that He distributes as He sees fit. Verse 12. For as the body is one and has many members, and all the members are of that one body, being many, are one body, so also is Christ. Everyone has a role. It's just that everyone has a different role to play. Everyone has a specific usage in the body of Christ. And He uses the word body of Christ in the illustrative sense of a physical body. And He'll get to that in just a little bit. Because by one Spirit, we're all baptized into one body. By the same Spirit who distributes these miraculous gifts, by that same Spirit, we are added to the one body. How? Under the Old Testament, the Israelites would offer sacrifices through the priest by the law. Well, the law wasn't offering the sacrifices. Laws are just listings of what is right and wrong. But by the law, they knew what to offer. They could read the law, and they could follow the law. Thus, they knew how and when and why to offer their sacrifices. Sacrifices offered by the law. Well, here he says we're baptized by the Spirit. Not baptized into the Spirit. Not baptized in the Spirit. But baptized by the Spirit. It doesn't mean the Spirit dunks me in the water and lifts me up. It means by the teaching of the Spirit. By knowing and obeying the words of the Spirit. My Bible, I am baptized into one body, the body of Jesus Christ. Whether we be Jews or Gentiles, it's irrelevant. Whether we be slaves or free, it's irrelevant. We are all made to drink into one Spirit, because it is by the teaching of that one Spirit that we're all baptized. So, we're all many members, but we all are all a part of one body. Verse 14, for the body is not one member, but many. Don't confuse one body with one member. It's many members of one body. If the foot, now he uses a physical body as his illustration, if the foot should say, because I'm not the hand, I am not of the body, is it therefore not the body? No, the foot is just as much a part of the body as the hand, it just serves a different role. If the ear shall say, because I'm not the eye, I am not of the body, is it therefore not of the body? It serves a different role, but it's still just as much part of the body. Verse 17. If the whole body were an eye, how would you hear? If the whole were a hear or an ear, how would you smell? But now has God set the members, every one of them, in the body as it pleases Him. I might be a foot in the kingdom of God. You might be a hand in the kingdom of God. Someone else might be an eye in the kingdom of God. But I am what I am. The function that I serve, the role that I play as a preacher or a teacher, is the role that I have to play because that's the role that is given to me by Christ. It is not my place to say, well, how come you get to be that when I want to be that? Well, maybe I'm not good at being a song leader, so I shouldn't be upset that he can lead singing when I can't. I should just focus on the role that I can play. Verse 18. But now has God set members, every one of them, in the body as it pleases Him. Just as it said earlier in verse 11, that the Spirit divides the miraculous gifts among members as it pleases Him, so does Christ have those in the body performing the roles that they play in the body as it pleases Him. Verse 19. And if they were all one member, where would be the body? If the entire congregation at Corinth was just one member, then it wouldn't be a body. It would be one member. It would be one big eye, or one big hand, or one big foot, as he says in verse 20. But now are you many members, yet one body. The eye cannot say to the hand, I have no need of you. Nor again could the head say to the feet, I have no need of you. If the entire congregation of Corinth was one person, then anybody who came, that one person could just kick them out. That one person would have all of the authority, would have all of the say, would have all of the power. But that flies in the face of unity. It flies in the face of cooperation, which implies there's multiple individuals having to work together. His point is, work together, Corinthian Christians. Verse 22, nay, much more those members of the body, which seem to be more feeble, are necessary. In other words, even the littlest parts of the body are needed. The role that you play in your congregation might seem insignificant compared to some other roles that others play, but you're playing a role. Therefore, it is significant. If it wasn't significant, you wouldn't have a role. But because you have any role, it's a significant one. 23. And those members of the body which we think to be less honorable, upon these we bestow more abundant honor. In other words, we ought to bestow more abundant honor. I think it's clear that they weren't in Corinth, but they should have been. And our uncomely parts have more abundant comeliness. In other words, even the parts that we would consider worthless, that we would say, well, just cover them up and just be done with them, have a role and a function to perform in this grand body of Jesus Christ. This is a one big illustration that he's describing here. 24. For our comely parts have no need, but God has tempered the body together, has given more abundant honor to that part which lacked. In other words, you have different roles to play. You're all different, yet you're all equal, and you're all equally special in the Christ who is the head of this body. And so therefore you should bestow more honor to those who seem to be the least important, which is a very common Christian principle, which always teaches it's better to be the last than the first, that you should desire those ahead of you than yourself. So Paul's basically saying, rearrange your perspective. You who have a high place of prominence and position of awareness in the congregation, start looking to those who are the opposite of you, who are seemingly at the bottom of the totem pole, who are seemingly ignored, and start building them up and start extolling them and encouraging them, so that you eventually become one complete circle, every single individual part of that body having a part to play and is equal. 25. To the end that there should be no schism, division, in the body, but that the members should have the same care one for another, regardless of stature or status in the congregation or in society or wherever. You should have the same care one for another. That same word, that word same, is very important. And whether one member suffer, all the members should suffer. Or where one member is honored, all the members should rejoice with it. It's easy for a congregation to sorrow with the sorrowing member. One member is going through a difficult time. It's easy to sympathize and to feel sorrow and pity. It is much harder a lot of times for us to rejoice in someone else's well-doing. The common inclination for people is to say, well, why not me? Where's my rejoicing? Where's my good day? Where's my good thing that happens? But it's still the Christian responsibility to rejoice in those who rejoice, as it is to weep with those who weep. He's teaching unity here in good and bad. Now, 27, now you are the body of Christ and members in particular. In other words, each serving a particular purpose. It's the same word, in fact, that it will come up in chapter 13, that word particular, when he starts talking about the individual time period wherein these miraculous gifts took place. But we'll get to that when we get to chapter 13. Now you are the body of Christ, and members in particular, and God has set some in the church, the same Lord who appoints the positions and the particular roles. He set some in the church, gave them a position, some apostles, Christ's ambassadors. Secondarily, prophets, that means just below them, that is those who have been inspired to speak and to preach. Third, teachers, those who are uninspired but still speak and preach and teach. After them, those who simply work miracles and gifts of healing and helps and governments and diversities of tongues. All of those who perform these miraculous gifts, those who don't have an office of authority, but they have these gifts given to them, they're needed. Because without them, without this person over here who speaks in tongues, though he's not an elder or a preacher, without this person who can interpret the tongues, though he's not a deacon, you need them. Without them, you can't have a functioning congregation in the first century. How could you know who's teaching truth or error, for example? Helpers, the word used in verse 28, after he says prophets, teachers, miracles, gifts of healing, helps, that is the same word in Galatians 6 where he says, you who are spiritual, help someone who's overcome with a burden. That word spiritual doesn't just mean someone who is spiritually minded. It means someone who has the ability, the miraculously granted ability, to help them overcome. Again, 21st century application is someone who is well fitted to that task. But in the first century, it's a specifically appointed person with a gift. Or all apostles. He says in verse 28 in that big verse, everyone has these different roles to play, these different functions, whether it's as an apostle or a prophet or a teacher or a miraculous doer or someone who can heal or help or who has a function in government. I take that within the confines of the congregation to be an elder or a deacon perhaps. Diversities of tongues, the speaking of tongues, which you'll get to in the next couple of chapters. All these different functions, but is everybody an apostle? If everybody was an apostle, then what role would the apostles, the office of an apostle, be needed? If everybody occupied the same role, nobody would need the role. The whole purpose of these individual roles is for this one who occupies the role to help those who don't, and for this one who occupies this role to help those who don't. The one to teach teaches those who aren't teachers. The ones who can speak in tongues speak to those who can't speak in tongues. So you perform the function for everybody. Then someone else performs the function for everybody on their end. Or is everyone an apostle? Is everyone a prophet? Is everyone a teacher? Are all workers of miracles? Verse 29. Have you all gifts of healing? Do all speak in tongues? Does everyone interpret? No, these gifts were given individually so that everyone would have to work together. Why weren't they working together? What's the problem at Corinth? It's not division. The problem sparked division. Not sparked from division. The problem caused division. The problem is a lack of love. Because they don't love, they're divided. Because they don't love, they're suing each other. Because they don't love, they won't withdraw fellowship from a sinful brother. Because they don't love, they are binding their scruples. Because they don't love, they're not paying their preacher. Because they don't love, on and on and on throughout this book. All of these problems ties back to the fact that they don't love. And because they don't love, they're misusing and abusing their miraculous gifts. Have all the gifts of healing? Do all speak in tongues? Do all interpret? No. But covet earnestly the best gifts. After everything he said, he's not saying avoid having miraculous gifts. He's not saying run away from the gifts that you've been given. Desire these gifts, but I show you a more excellent way. While you're desiring to have these gifts with the right attitude to use them for the betterment of the entire congregation, let me now lay out the case for something greater than any miracle, greater than any tongue speaking or interpretation of tongue, greater than any faith that can move mountains, greater than any healing of any blind or deaf or lame or what have you, greater than any miraculous striking of a person blind or even striking of a person dead, greater than any miracle that you could ever see or experience is this greatest of all. Which is love, chapter 13, which we'll discuss this time next week. Until then, that's chapter 12. Thank you so much.